We're studying about the fourth angel's message. It's a continuation of the series we've been doing for a few months on the three angels' messages. And when we talk about the three angels' messages, we generally think of three. After all, three angels' messages. But as we've been studying, we found out that there is something that we call a fourth angel, or another angel that comes down from heaven in Revelation 18 that's mentioned, that's very vital to understand. And so we're going to continue where we left off last week. But before we do, I want to go to our second slide, and we're just going to read through these verses in Revelation 18 that particularly attend to this message. In Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1, "And after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory." In verse 2, "And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird." In verse 3, "For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies." And then in verse 4, he says, "And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people." This voice says, "Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues." And verse 5, "For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities." When we closed our last session, we were starting to go through these five verses, verse by verse, and we were still in verse 1. And I don't know if we can finish these today. I don't know if my voice will hold up to finish them today, but we're going to try. We're going to see what we can do. And if not, then we'll finish next week. But I want to read a statement to you from the book Great Controversy. And before we read this statement, though, there's a principle of interpretation that I'd like for us to consider. Not all prophecy is understood when it is first given by a prophet. For example, in the 8th chapter of Daniel, Daniel was given some things that were plain to understand. For instance, the ram which thou sawest having two horns are the kings of Mede and Persia. The rough goat is the king of Grecia. Those were very easy, very plain to understand. But there were other parts that caused Daniel to be so disturbed that he actually fainted. And he didn't have understanding of those things at that time. And he had to wait for the vision of chapter 9 to happen, so that he could understand more of the details. Clearly, none of the Adventist pioneers understood Daniel 8:14 until after 1844. But prophecy is not given simply to tell the future. It does a pretty good job at that. But there's another vital, important point, and it's found in John chapter 13 and verse 19. John chapter 13, verse 19. Jesus says, "Now I tell you before it come, that when it is come to pass, ye may believe." There's an aspect of prophecy that is designed to not only tell us what's going to happen, but to build faith. And you remember in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, it says, "Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing what? The Word of God." And prophecy is part of the Word of God, isn't it? And so as we study these prophecies, as we see these chains of prophecy that we discussed in our Sabbath school, and we see them being fulfilled link by link by link, it helps us to have confidence that we can believe. Sometimes we don't always understand a prophecy until it has been fulfilled. And I would like to propose that part of the following prophecy comes under that category. And so in Great Controversy, on pages 606 to 607, we're going to read this. It says, "Thus the message of the third angel will be proclaimed. As the time comes for it to be given, with greatest power, the Lord will work through humble instruments, leading the minds of those who consecrate themselves to his service. The laborers will be qualified rather by the unction of his spirit than by the training of literary institutions. Men of faith and prayer will be constrained or propelled to go forth with holy zeal, declaring the words which God gives them." Notice, "The sins of Babylon will be laid open. The fearful results of enforcing the observances of the church by civil authority, the inroads of spiritualism, the stealthy but rapid progress of the papal power, all will be unmasked." Let me just pause for a minute. One of the points about this says that there is the fearful results of enforcing the observances of the church by civil authorities. Do you know any churches that require the civil authorities to enforce their dogma upon people? People who want to use a particular name, like a trademark name? It goes on to say, by these solemn warnings, the people will be stirred. Thousands upon thousands will listen who have never heard words like these. In amazement, they hear the testimony that Babylon is the church, fallen because of her errors and sins, because of her rejection of the truth sent to her from heaven. You see, friends, truth once accepted can be rejected. We call that apostasy. If I was asked, for instance, are Buddhists in apostasy? Is Islam in apostasy? I would say no. It's not truth, for sure. But apostasy means that you once held a position of truth and you've fallen into error, or you've left that truth behind. These people didn't have the truth to start with, you see. But truth once accepted can be rejected. And the rejection doesn't have to be at the beginning. Ellen White doesn't say in this testimony, in this prophecy, which churches are meant. She says, in amazement, the churches hear that they're Babylon. She doesn't say which ones. But you know, there's an old proverb that we use here in the hills, and it just says that if the shoe fits, wear it. Have you ever heard that? If the shoe fits, wears it. In other words, friends, if we meet the conditions, or any church, any group meets the conditions, then it has to be able to be applicable. Furthermore, we, our people, we will be held accountable in the degree that we have had opportunity to have truth. Ellen White speaks of the fearful results of enforcing the observances of the church by the civil authorities. You say, well, you know, Adventist people, we wouldn't do that. We're people of religious liberty. We wouldn't do that. But I just want you to try this. Open your computer, go to Google, and just type in trademark SDA and see what happens. You're going to find out that this church has, in fact, used the civil authorities a lot to sue people, to enforce, under the threat of being put in jail, their trademark name. In other words, If you're not a member of the corporate church and your church isn't a corporate church, and you try to use the name Seventh-day Adventist, you can be sued for that. You can be taken to jail and put in jail for that. And it's happened. It's happened. I remember a few years ago, we were in St. Louis for the 2005 General Conference session. And we were on the public streets handing out literature. But the people inside the dome that were having the General Conference session didn't like it. And so they asked me to come into that meeting with some of the security people, a meeting with the security people. And I said, well, I'd like to talk to some of the Seventh-day Adventist people here, you know, because these people are people of religious liberty. They can't mind what we're doing. And they said, they don't want to talk to you. I said, well, could you just ask them? Well, they don't want to talk to you. I said, would you just ask? So they did ask, and two people came from the security department of the General Conference. It was a lady and a man. And the lady said, do you understand we don't like what you're doing? We don't want you to do this. I said, yes, I do understand that. I said, but I used to belong to this church. I was a member in good and regular standing at one time. And we've always believed in religious freedom, that people could say what they believed, you know, in public. And with just a hatefulness in her voice and an expression, she wagged her finger in my face. And she says, this has nothing to do with the religious liberty. We're not talking about that. She says, do you not understand that if you do not cease to desist, that we will have you prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law? I said, yeah, I understand that. She says, well, are you going to quit? I said, well, you do what you got to do, and I'll do what I have to do, you know. But we checked out the streets, the sidewalks. We knew what was public property, and we were well within our legal right to be exactly where we were. But because they didn't like the message, they were going to try to force us off, and they were going to use the state to do it. There are many different groups of Baptists. Here in West Virginia, we have a lot of Baptists. We have Southern Baptists, American Baptists, Free Will Baptist, Hard Shell Baptist, Independent Baptist. Been going a lot about Baptist. But, you know, as problematic as the theology is in some of the Baptist churches, I've never heard of one suing another for using the name Baptist. Have you? They wouldn't dare do that. They'd never think of doing that. And yet, they experienced a moral fall in 1844. But we say that Adventism has not had, or nor even can have, any such fall. Revelation chapter 18, verse 2, again, he says, "And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great has fallen, has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird." Now, a habitation is a dwelling place. As Christians, we are not to partake of the things of the world. If you were to go, for instance, to a carnival, you might find something called a haunted house. You ever hear something like a haunted house? You see that advertised during what we call Halloween a lot. It's a house that is staged to have frightful appearances, usually by things that have spiritualistic associations. And as Christians, we believe in such things as reality, truth. We don't believe in falsehoods. We don't believe in staging falsehoods. In the Bible, we read not simply about houses, but about human beings being inhabited or possessed by demons. This is a reality. It is a reality that there are demonic forces in the world that we live. And I would dare say that except for good angels, demonic angels would be here trying to destroy us and to pervert this message. Now I'll ask you a question. We all have a house, an apartment, someplace we live. If you knew your house was inhabited by evil spirits, by demons, by devils, and that you couldn't get them to leave, would you go home today?
No.
Would you even live? You wouldn't live there. You wouldn't even go home, let alone live there, would you? You wouldn't want to stay someplace that you knew was a habitation of devils. But the text says that Babylon has fallen and it has become a living place for the demons. It's a hold of every foul spirit and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Now, there's two words in this verse. One word is hold. And I have it italicized here, and I really should have had cage italicized also. Because these two words come from the same Greek word. And that Greek word is phyleke. And it simply means prison. It means prison. These words could have been better, more accurately translated, prison. It says, "And it's become the habitation of devils and the prison of every foul spirit and the prison of every unclean and hateful bird." Well, the good news is that Babylon is a living place or a prison for demons. It's the only place that you find them. So if you can avoid Babylon, you can avoid the demons. But if you tread into Babylon, you're going to be walking with demons. Demons will not be with God's people, for they have allowed the three angels' messages to do their work, and they've responded to the message of the fourth angel to come out of Babylon. Babylon is said to be the hold or the prison of every foul spirit. By the way, here I'll just show you. There is this word that we mentioned earlier that is translated hold and means prison. Also translated cage, if you want the Greek on it. And then there's another word here that we want to look at. It's akathetos, and it's the word that's translated foul in Revelation 18:2. And it's also used in a couple other texts we will look at. One is in Mark 9:25. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, "Thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him." It's used in this verse. It's also used in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 43. When the unclean spirit had gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none. And so that's the same word, akathetos. And so it's speaking about unclean or foul, wicked spirits. Babylon is also a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. In Jeremiah chapter 5 and verses 26 and 27, he says, "For among my people are found wicked men. They lie wait as he that setteth snares. They set a trap, they catch men. As a cage is full of birds, so are their houses full of deceits. Jeremiah here, he compares houses of deceits with the cages of birds. But instead of doing wickedness, the people should have been, according to the verses just prior to this, they should have been praying for the early and latter rain. Sadly, though, instead of praying for the Spirit of God, they've been brought into a place of deceit and deception. In Revelation chapter 18, verse 3, he says, "For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies." All nations, all people. The root word for nations is ethnos, and is usually translated Gentiles. But we get our word ethnic from this word. God is saying that all people who are not saved will receive the wine of his wrath. And he speaks about the kings and the merchants of the earth, and that they've committed fornication with her. Both the civil and the laity are here, and they have profited by the abundance of her delicacies. And it's interesting that the word abundance here, the word abundance is a Greek word dunamis that you've probably heard of before. And it's a Greek word that's translated many times power, but it's a word that we get our English word dynamite from. It means explosive power. Through the abundance, through the power of her delicacies. But the word rendered delicacies is strenos, and it occurs nowhere else in the New Testament. But it properly means rudeness, insolence, pride, hence revel, riot, and luxury. And so the last part of this verse could actually be translated, "So through the power of her rudeness and her arrogance, she is ruled." Through the power of her arrogance and rudeness, she is ruled. In verse 4 of Revelation 18, "I heard another voice from heaven saying, 'Come out of her, my people.'" Now this voice is a different kind of voice than some of the others that we've heard, because this voice is of divine origin. For no angel can call God's people my people. That's possessive. Amen. That's possessive. Now we have a direct command. But who does this command come? It comes from God himself. Notice this parallel kind of thought here in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. He says, "What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, which ye have of God? And ye are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are God's." So this is a call from God in heaven telling us to come out. God has bought us, and he has paid for us. Peter says, "With the precious blood of Jesus Christ," 1 Peter 1:18. He wants us for eternity. But if we don't come out of Babylon, it says that we will become partakers of her sins, we will receive of her plagues, and we'll be lost. Now, according to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, how was mankind originally made? According to Genesis 1:26, you know the text, right? In the image of God, he created him. And God is holy. And he wants his people to be holy. He says here in 1 Peter 1:16, he says, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." If we're to be in his image, and he's holy, and he tells us to be holy, he wants us to be holy. That's not that hard to understand, is it? But friends, if we're not a holy people, we're not going to be able to spend eternity with God. It's just that simple. The plagues are going to fall on those who are lost in sin. And while according to Great Controversy, page 628, not all the plagues are universal, the first plague, we are told, falls upon the men which had the mark of the beast and upon them which worshipped his image, Revelation 16:2. Maybe not all of those seven glass plagues are universal, but this one is universal. Everyone who receives the mark of the beast will be a partaker of that plague. Those people who receive the mark of the beast cannot be saved. Not according to the third angel's message. If we don't come out of Babylon, we're going to be lost. Notice what Isaiah says in Isaiah 13:19. He says, "And Babylon, the glory of kingdoms, the beauty of the Chaldees, excellency, shall be as when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah." How did God overthrow Sodom and Gomorrah? According to Jude 1, verse 7, Sodom and Gomorrah are suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. And when God destroys mystic Babylon, friends, it will not come back. And if we stay in Babylon, we're going to be destroyed with it. It's just that plain. All those people that were in Sodom and Gomorrah, they were destroyed when those cities were destroyed. Now, concerning this, there are two issues that we should consider. Firstly, there is an issue of corporate accountability. What do you mean corporate accountability? Corporate. A corporation comes from the Latin corpus. It means body. And so you have a church body, a corporation, or a corporate body. We call it, maybe it may not be a legal corporation, but it's still a corporate body. It's a group. And God. God, if you think back to the book of Joshua in the 7th chapter, you have the story of Achan. Remember the story of Achan? He found a piece of gold, a wedge of gold. He found a what he called a goodly Babylonish garment. I'm not sure what made it good, but he thought it was. And only Achan and his family knew that he had taken these things and hid them in his tent. But when Israel, who had had a great victory at Jericho, went to take a much smaller, weaker city, Ai, they were defeated, and over 30 men were killed. Over 30 men died needlessly. And God says, because there's an accursed thing among you. And he held the whole nation accountable for what one man did. And that reminds me of something Ellen White wrote in Volume 7 of the Testimonies on page 269. She said, God holds his people as a body responsible for the sins existing in individuals among them. In other words, friends, there's a corporate accountability. We have an individual responsibility, but there's also a corporate accountability. And it's a solemn thought. We might believe that we can be a part of an apostate body and not participate in the apostasy. But God says that if you're going to be a part of this, then you're going to be held accountable for what goes on. If you're there, you better be speaking up and attempting to do something to stifle the sin and the wickedness. Don't think that you can be neutral. Don't think that you can just ride the middle of a fence and still keep God's pleasure, because it can't happen. I want to show you why it can't happen. In Volume 3 of the Testimonies, on page 281, Ellen White makes this statement. It's a very profound statement. She says, indifference and neutrality in a religious crisis is regarded of God as a grievous crime and equal to the very worst type of hostility against God. Taking a neutral position, not being willing to speak out against things that we know are wrong, doctrines that we know are wrong, lifestyles that we know are wrong, things that are happening. You know, I may not be able to fix everything. I may not be able to fix anything. But I have to do what I can do if I'm going to be a part of that corporate body. And if you are simply neutral, then God counts that worse than being in open hostility against him. That would be bad enough. If I was in open hostility against God, that would be terrible. But she says that this is worse. It's worse, friends, because it leads other people into the same position. Amen. Secondly, there's a principle that people are affected by their environment. We know that in 2 Corinthians 3:18, but we all with open face, beholding as a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image by glory to glory, even through the Spirit of the Lord. We know that by beholding we become changed, right? In 1 Samuel 15, we find what sounds like one of the cruelest commands in the Bible. 1 Samuel 15, verse 1. Samuel also said unto Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint thee to be king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore hearken thou unto the voice of the words of the Lord. Verse 2. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, I remember that which Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way when he came up from Egypt. Now, go and smite Amalek, and utterly destroy all that they have, and spare them not, but slay both man and woman, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass. Slay everything. That doesn't sound initially like a God of love, does it? It doesn't sound like someone who cares. Even the infants and the sucklings must be destroyed. The animals must be destroyed. We need to understand, friends, that the nation of Amalek had committed the unpardonable sin. And those people had become so vile and so wicked that the children were even so corrupted by their surroundings, even the infants, that I suppose even genetically as well as environmentally, they were beyond being helped. Because, friends, God doesn't draw a line unless we've passed probation, what probation can do for us. Even the children had crossed a line that was not visible to human eyes. The wicked environment of sin had so contaminated the children that even they must be destroyed. Today, archaeologists have revealed some of the great wickedness of the nations upon whom Israel was to bring judgment. We might wonder why the animals were not spared. Surely they could not sin, but today we know that many of the animals were sick, they had venereal diseases, and they were slain because of that. Is it any wonder that God had to destroy them? Now, is there anywhere else in the Bible that we find something concerning a destruction of the wicked? Well, I want you to notice a reference from Ezekiel chapter 9, verses 5 and 6, and also something that Ellen White mentions here concerning this. It says, "Go ye after him through the city, and smite. Let not your eyes spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women." And that's what the destroying angel was commanded to do in Ezekiel 9, verses 5 and 6. And Ellen White just says, "Men, maidens, and little children all perish together." Why? Why does it happen to the children? Because, friends, their environment had become so tainted that they also had become corrupted to the point of no return. I would say to parents, please think twice about every influence that is upon and around your children. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7, God says He will not be mocked. He will not be mocked. If we put our young people in the wrong environment, friends, it's going to have an effect upon them. If you have children and you allow them to be in Babylon, you're preparing them for eternal loss. You may think that both you and they are strong enough to resist the influences, but God will not be mocked. I want you to notice what Ellen White says in early writings on page 245. She says, "But all who received it," referring to the fourth angel's message, "withdrew from the world and were closely united with one another." We have to withdraw from the world, the things of the world. And if the churches have become worldly, we have to withdraw from those churches. Continuing in early writings, this is starting on page 277. She says, "Angels were sent to aid the mighty angel from heaven." Let me just pause. Who is that mighty angel from heaven?
Jesus.
No. Think back to your text in Revelation 18. It's the angel, it's the fourth angel. The other angel comes down with mighty power. It says, "Angels were sent to aid the mighty angel from heaven, and I heard voices which seemed to sound everywhere, 'Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues, for her sins have reached into heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities.'" Continuing, this message seemed to be in addition to the third message, joining it as the midnight cry joined the second angel's message in 1844. "The glory of God rested upon the patient, waiting saints, and they fearlessly gave the last solemn warning, proclaiming the fall of Babylon and calling upon God's people to come out of her that they might escape her fearful doom." And then, "The light that was shed upon the waiting ones penetrated everywhere, and those in the churches who had any light, who had not heard and rejected the three messages, obeyed the call and left the fallen churches. Many had come to years of accountability since these messages had been given, and the light shone upon them, and they were privileged to choose life or death." Continuing, Some chose life and took their stand with those who were looking for their Lord and keeping all his commandments. The third message was to do its work. All were to be tested upon it, and the precious ones were to be called out from the religious bodies. A compelling power moved the honest, while the manifestation of the power of God brought a fear and restraint upon their unbelieving relatives and friends, so they dared not, neither had they the power to hinder those who felt the work of the Spirit of God upon them. The last call was carried even to the poor slave, and the pious among them poured forth their songs of rapturous joy at the prospect of their happy deliverance. And by the way, if you don't think there's slavery in the world now, you don't understand what's happening. There's more slavery in the world today than there's ever been in the history of this world. It says, their masters could not check them. Fear and astonishment kept them silent. Mighty miracles were wrought. The sick were healed, and signs and wonders followed the believers. God was in the work, and every saint, fearless of consequences, followed the convictions of his own conscience and united with those who were keeping all the commandments of God, and with power they sounded abroad the third message. I saw that this message will close with power and strength far exceeding the midnight cry. Well, that midnight cry, it was sort of like the standard. It was the gold standard of what it meant to give a message with power in those days. But she says that this will be given with even more power and more than was the midnight cry. Beloved, we must flee Babylon while we can still flee and free ourselves from its sticky tentacles. Because the longer we wait to leave, the harder it will be. You know, Lot learned that lesson. Also in the city of St. Louis, I had an experience that I'd like to share with you. And this was a few years prior to being there for the General Conference session. But if you remember, several years ago, Pope John Paul was visiting in St. Louis. And I'd went with some other people to pass out literature at the event. And we did. And I had a chance to stay with a man, stay in a church. In fact, several stayed in a church. We'd been invited to stay in a church. Of a man who was a former Seventh-day Adventist minister. He was a former Seventh-day Adventist minister. And he had joined up with in an association with a Baptist group sharing their building. The Baptists worshipped on Sunday, the Adventists worshipped on Saturday. This man also had become imbibed in the local ministerial association. And he became so involved in it, he actually became the president of the Ministerial Association of St. Louis, which is a pretty big position. Well, the Pope's coming to St. Louis, and the Ministerial Association has been granted the privilege by the city to welcome the Pope. And the Ministerial Association has asked the head of the Ministerial Association to be the person who actually gives him the key to the city and welcomes him. Who was this former Seventh-day Adventist. He's still a Seventh-day Adventist in practice now, but just not a member of the corporate church, see. So that's a lesson we're going to deal with here, too, in just a minute. And he was like between a rock and a hard place because he's been hobnobbing with these people so much. How can he now tell them that he can't do this? On the other hand, how can he break his conscience and welcome the vicar of Satan to his city? And I was sitting in his office about 3 hours before this event was supposed to happen. And he was sweating profusely. And he just said, I just don't know what I'm going to do. And Sister Ann, Brother Doug Goslin was there. And Doug said, I'd know what I'd do. I'd tell him, you're the Antichrist. You know, Doug. Doug was just that way. And so what he eventually did, he eventually welcomed the Pope as a civil authority and not a religious authority to the town. He tried to somehow compromise his position. But he had become so imbibed and so intertwined in this system that he found it almost impossible to leave it. And so you don't have to be a member of a corporate church. You could be out here like people like us who are, we would be called by others dissidents or independents or whatever, you can still become so intertwined with Babylon it becomes hard to leave. I'm not trying to pick on just any one group of people. I'm trying to say here's the reality of the situation that no matter who we are, no matter where we're at, if we start to become intertwined, we can be lost. I encourage this brother to contact the organizers of the event and just say, you know, I just can't participate in this. I just can't do this. But he was in so deep he didn't know how to even do that. But in that event, beloved, I saw a microcosm of what it's going to be like for many Adventist people when the mark of the beast is urged upon our people. Because step by step, compromise has prepared the people to accept the mark of the beast. And we've been told by inspiration in Volume 5 of the Testimonies on page 81, the time is not far distant when the test will come to every soul. The mark of the beast will be urged upon us. Those who have step by step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be rather than subject themselves to derision, insult, threatened imprisonment, and death. And death. Because we know that the mark of the beast crisis is going to involve a death penalty. This is not going to be just simply being put in the local jail for 10 days. It's not even going to be having all of your property confiscated. It means your very life can be at stake. And if we have step by step conformed to worldly practices and step by step we have aligned ourselves with the world and the demands of the world, then we will not find it a hard matter to accept the mark of the beast. Friends, God is going to finish his work in a way that will not seem common or ordinary. And he must do that because the common order of the churches has become Babylon. In Manuscript Releases, Volume 2, on page 19, we are told, unless those who can help are aroused to a sense of their duty, they will not recognize the work of God when the loud cry of the third angel shall be heard. When light goes forth to lighten the earth, instead of coming up to the help of the Lord, they will want to bind about his work to meet their narrow ideas. And then she continues, let me tell you that the Lord will work in this last work in a manner very much out of the common order of things and in a way that will be contrary to any human planning. Manuscript Release, Volume 2, page 19. So, dearly beloved, we are told in the book of Hebrews that we are to lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and to run this race that we have before us with patience, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Beloved, we have a work ahead of us, a great work. And we of all people are living in the very last days. We're living, friends, in the last link of those prophetic chains. We're living in the last link of those prophetic chains. And we've been privileged to do that during the time of the loud cry. What a shame it would be if we do not fulfill the work of that other angel when it joins with the voice of the third angel and swells to a loud cry. In early writings, also on page 261, she says, I saw that God has honest children among the nominal Adventists and the fallen churches. And before the plague shall be poured out, ministers and people will be called out from these churches and will gladly receive the truth. Satan knows this. And before the loud cry the third angel is given, he raises an excitement in these religious bodies that those who have rejected the truth may think that God is with them. He hopes to deceive the honest and lead them to think that God is still working for the churches. But the light will shine and all who are honest will leave the fallen churches and take their stand with the remnant. To the unstudied eye, the untrained eye, it's going to look like God's in it. It's going to look like things are going onward and upward to heaven. It's going to look like the latter rain's being poured out. Thousands are going to be converted in a day, it seems. And yet, we are told that the light's going to shine. And there will be people who are honest at heart. And they will be able to know the difference. Ellen White says that there will be people in the churches that believe that God is still working for them. The health programs and the hospitals are still serving people. Evangelism is still pushing forward. But these things are simply a smokescreen of Satan to make the people think that God is still involved. In closing, friends, I want to share a statement that must be considered in its time and place. And this is from the 1888 materials, pages 356 and 357. She says, I was confirmed in all that I had stated in Minneapolis, that a reformation must go through the churches. Reforms must be made, for spiritual weakness and blindness were upon the people who had been blessed with great light and precious opportunities and privileges. Let me just pause. If you're not familiar with the history, in 1888, there was a general conference session of the Adventist people held in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And it has been perhaps become the most famous of all general conference sessions among Adventist people because there was a great controversy there on the issue of righteousness by faith and other issues as well. And God had sent two young men, elders A.T. Jones and E.J. Wagner, there to present a special message, the third angel's message in verity, we were told. And so there was, at that time, a great upheaval going in the church, and people were concerned about things. And then Ellen White goes on to say, as reformers, they had come out of the denominational churches, but they now act a part similar to that which the churches acted. We hoped that there would not be the necessity for another coming out. While we will endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace, we will not with pen or voice cease to protest against bigotry. Now, in Ellen White's time, she did not call for, did not advocate, promote, or in any way by her precept or example, call for another coming out. She says another coming out. She's referring to the coming out of the churches in 1844, from those churches in 1844 to the Advent movement. And she says, we'd hope that there wouldn't be another coming out. We wouldn't have to have a need for it. But what she is saying in that, if you'll just think about it, what she is saying is that there is a possibility there could be another coming out. There is this idea in Adventism that there can be no other coming out. There could never be a coming out. There can never be another situation to happen. After all, they will say there's no eighth church. We are Laodicea. There's no eighth church. There can't be another coming out. But friends, that's looking at the situation very simplistic. But I'm just saying that she is saying that there could be another coming out. And the question is, does the shoe fit? And if the shoe fits, then we should wear it. When she says that there was to be a reformation going through the churches, she wasn't talking about the Baptist churches. She wasn't talking about the Methodist church. She was talking about the Seventh-day Adventist people. Ellen White didn't say in this statement that there had to be another coming out or that there would be another coming out, but that she was looking for things and hoping for things to get better after 1880, but she certainly made provision that there could be another coming out at that time. There might indeed have to be another coming out. Just as when she and the early pioneers received the light of the second angel's message that Babylon had fallen and obeyed that call in 1844 to come out of those churches. Friends, it depends upon the actions of men and women and how history is written out. When Ellen White said there might have to be another coming out, she was speaking specifically of a coming out of the Advent Church. Her statement was written in 1889. What would Ellen White say today? Because that's what's important. Time and place have to be considered. And what would she say today? If she was to look at the way the doctrines have been changed, if she was to look at the way the very pillars of our faith have been undermined, if she was to look at the way the dress standards and the lifestyle standards have been so lowered, if she was to look at so many of these things, what would she say today? And the real issue is not so much what would Ellen White say, but it's what would Jesus say, because what she was giving to our people was simply the testimony of Jesus. That's what the spirit of prophecy is. It's not the voice of the prophet. It's the voice of Jesus working through the prophet. What would Ellen White say today if she could see the corruptions that have entered into the church since 1844? I believe that she would proclaim exactly what God says in Revelation 18, verse 4, with a loud voice. Beloved, the fourth angel gives us a command to leave Babylon or we will be lost. God's not going to force anyone to leave. He didn't force Lot to leave Sodom and Gomorrah. And Mrs. Lot decided that she was ready to turn back. And he allowed her to have that. He will allow you to be lost if you cherish a church organization more than fellowship with him. Those who are truly honest and willing to know and follow the truth will do so, for we have told in John chapter 7 and verse 17, if any man will do his will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. My question for you is, will you do his will in the matter of the fourth angel? We'll have to decide for ourselves what that will is. I can't decide that for you. You can't decide it for me. But friends, we are responsible. We are responsible as a people to take the evidence that's set before us and understand what God wants, because he says, be ye holy for I am holy. We were made in His image and we were made to be holy. And you can't... Listen, here, those of us from the mountains here, we know that you can't go out and get in the hog pen and stay clean. It's just that simple. You can't go out and stay in filth and be clean. You've got to put yourself into a clean environment and stay clean. And God wants His people to be holy. Now, it's true, we have a world to warn. We have people to help. We have to go out to where the people are. I'm not saying we don't go out to where the people are. But friends, by beholding, we become changed. And if we continually behold the wrong things, it's going to change us. And even if you think you're strong enough not to be affected by those things, remember that there is a corporate accountability, that God holds His people accountable as a body for the sins of the individual members. And if we think that we can participate in these things and finally go to heaven and be ready for the time of trouble and to not accept the mark of the beast, we are kidding ourselves. Because if we have step-by-step conformed, then we will not find it such a hard matter to accept the mark of the beast. May God bless us, friends, to follow Him and follow Him fully. Don't worry about me. Don't worry about what I say. Don't worry about what I do. That's not what's important. It's what is the Word of God? What does the testimony say? What is truth for today? That's what's important for you today. And may God bless you lots and lots and lots.